Se me go.
A very good morning to one and all. On behalf of the Center for Environment, Climate Change and Sustainable Development at Impact and Policy Research Institute, I welcome you all to episode 5 of the State of the Environment, #PlanetTalks with me, Simi Mehta. COVID-19 has had its impact on almost every sector of local, national and global economy. The lockdown in India and around the world has witnessed a quintessential reduction and restriction on mobility, starting from walking on foot to flying in the aircrafts. The fast pace of transportation, movements of human and cargo from both inter and intra-country has come to a grinding halt. Perhaps one ethical argument in support for this is the public health security. But everything else, from incomes to those dependent upon mobility on road, air and water, remains compromised. As a result, it is very crucial to understand the core issues behind the mobility during and post-pandemic. To discuss this, we have with us Dr. Deepthi Jain, an expert on the subject on mobility, to share her views on the theme, Sustainable Mobility Amid the COVID-19 Pandemic, Potential Risks and Opportunities. It is my pleasure to introduce to you Dr. Deepthi Jain. Dr. Deepthi Jain is an assistant professor at the Terry School of Advanced Studies, New Delhi. Her areas of research include socio-environmental impact analysis, integrated land use, transportation planning, and modeling urban complexities. Dr. Jain has obtained her PhD in transportation research from the IIT Delhi. She holds a dual master's degree, master's in planning, in infrastructure planning for Center for Environmental Planning and Technology, Ahmedabad, and a master's in science in urban planning and management from ITC Twente University, the Netherlands. Dr. Jain has published journal articles and book chapters with internationally renowned publishers and has contributed to the development of revised comprehensive mobility planning toolkit adopted by the Ministry of Urban Development, Government of India. Thank you very much, ma'am, for joining us today, this morning, and I open the floor for you. Over to you, ma'am.
Thank you, Simi, for giving a nice introduction. So I'll just put forth my presentation over here.
Sure.
Good morning, everybody. Myself, Deepthi Jain, and today I'm going to talk about sustainable mobility amid the COVID-19 pandemic situation and what are the related potential risks and opportunities that can influence achieving the sustainable mobility targets for Indian cities. So starting, we all know that our cities are growing and the growing cities pose their own challenges in terms of requirement for space, or whether it's requirement for water, energy, or the kind of infrastructure that is required to provide shelters. As such, it is resulting in increasing the impact on infrastructure demand, increasing environmental impacts, consumption of resources, land, etc. Impact on ecosystems are also increasing. Not only this, different socio-economic strata of the society access the opportunities and infrastructure differently because of various reasons. Maybe their location where they live, maybe it is related to the income and the affordability, and whether they have access to the infrastructure or not, as such resulting in influencing the inequity. Now, what happens is when the cities are growing and our consumption of resources are increasing and environmental impacts are increasing, as such, we are also influencing the climate change, which in turn has an influence on the natural disasters. Now, for example, extreme weather events, the flood events, etc., they also are found to have influence on the way our infrastructure functions, how different people again access the different opportunities and infrastructure, and therefore it altogether adds back to the challenges of the growing cities. To address this, we have SDG 11, which talks about sustainable cities and communities, looking into the 5 basic heads, which include housing, mobility and accessibility, health, ecosystem services, and urban greens. Now, within this goal, we have goal number 11.2, which talks about transport and mobility. It addresses the need for access to safe, affordable, accessible, and sustainable transport systems. And the key word over here is for all, irrespective of the income, gender, ethnicity, age, etc., and including disability. It talks about and lays emphasis on expanding public transport infrastructure that is seen to provide a more affordable and accessible access to all. To address this goal, three specific targets have been identified, which includes reducing the road traffic deaths, provision of access to all the people to the all-weather roads, and percentage of people who are living within 0.5 kilometers of public transport system. So therefore, this goal is very much important and guiding the way mobility plans are being developed in all the cities across the world and India also. Now, talking about the existing travel patterns in Indian cities, this is a graph which is from five large size cities from India. And what we see over here is that irrespective of the type of city that we talk about, whether it's Patna or Hyderabad or Delhi, majority of the users are actually the public transport and non-motorized transport users, which means that majority of our travel patterns is dependent on the low carbon modes of transport. Therefore, we can also say that these are the trips that help us in already achieving one goal of sustainable mobility, that is reducing the environmental impacts. Also, if we look at the way and how much distance that the people travel, we would find that majority of the trips in any Indian city are actually the trips that are up to 5 kilometers. And these are the trips, specifically the trips that are less than 2 kilometers, can be identified as the potential trips for the walking. Whereas the trips that are up to 5 kilometers with appropriate infrastructure and built environment conditions, these trips can be brought onto the bicycles. So not only we have existing travel pattern in terms of model share, which is very much addressing the need for sustainable mobility, but also the distances that people travel lays emphasis on further improvement that can be easily achieved. So when we talk about low carbon mobility in Indian context, it talks about reducing the emission levels. Although globally we are producing lesser emissions per capita, but however these emission levels are likely to increase because again of the challenge of growing cities and economic development. So what we require in Indian context is to be able to retain the existing model shares and attract the potential non-motorized transport and public transport users that I have just shown in the previous graphs. Not only it can help in reducing the emission levels, but also provide better accessibility, safety, reduce noise, and address social equity and health improvement in cities. So as a complete definition, I would say for Indian cities, low carbon mobility can be defined as a system that can ensure safe, accessible transportation system for all the users, irrespective of gender, age, and income, such that it helps in improving human health and environment while reducing carbon content. So this is a wholesome definition that has now been adopted by the Ministry of Urban Development as well. So what we say about low carbon transport is that we have a need to meet our mobility demands by the least carbon emitting modes of transport. Therefore, it talks about non-motorized transport and public transport. So commonly we identify three key steps. First is retain. They retain the existing users of bicycles, retain the existing pedestrians and public transport users, cause the shift from the existing personal motorized vehicle users to the low carbon modes of transport. And last is talking about the technological improvement. Now, this is a famous diagram of how the emissions are calculated from a transportation sector. Now, in this particularly, you can see this orange circle and the gray circle. Now, within this orange circle, it specifically emphasizes on the improvement required from the technological side. which can include, for example, your vehicle technology improvement, fuel typology change, or emission standardizations. Whereas the second circle, which is this gray circle, is talking about the behavior change, where we are talking about how people travel, how do they access the different opportunities. And herein comes the question about designing the infrastructure and designing the cities in a way that can encourage people to use more and more bicycles, encourage people more to walk and use public transportation system. So the five key steps to achieve low carbon mobility, cause the model shift, reduce the distances over a longer period of time that can be addressed by the compact city concept. Then technological improvements, like I had mentioned earlier, which talks specifically about the fuel type change, vehicle efficiency, and emission standardization. In past few years, under the smart city paradigm, few cities have picked up specific projects towards improvisation of public transport system and non-motorized transport system. So within public transport system, the cities have picked up project which talks about improvising transit systems, application of IT system for better fleet management and better operation, issuing common cards and automatic fare collection systems for reducing, that can help in reducing the boarding and alighting times. Then providing in-bus information systems like the similar which we see in metro stations and in metro coaches. Then improvisation of paratransit facility that can help in complementing the existing public transport system. There are also few examples of non-motorized transport system, which includes provision of the infrastructure for both bicycles and pedestrians in few cities, and also development and application of public bicycle sharing system. So, Indore has gone a step ahead where they have also built up a project around implementation of pedestrian and bicycle accentuated traffic signals that can help in improvising the safety and accessibility of the non-motorized transport users. Other than the government initiatives, because of various demand, specifically the increasing demand for door-to-door service in transportation sector, various organizations and companies had come up that talk about carpooling. And it is obviously the very few list of these companies. And as we can see that each of these have certain limitations and there are certain features that provide benefits to the users. So, but now the question is that this was all existing in the pre-COVID era. Now, what is going to happen now with all of these schemes and with all of these implementations? So not only this, we have the existing challenge also. Even if the COVID situation was not there, then also the challenge of the growing cities is not going anywhere. This particular graph is showing how many districts are there with long distance trips. And we have divided districts into two clusters. The first cluster, that is cluster group one, are the districts that are highly economically producing. For example, they have higher share of tertiary sector, their economic index is also high. And cluster group two are the districts that have lesser economic production. Now, what we see over here is that we have more number of districts in cluster group one that have a longer share of or a higher share of long distance trips. And this long distance trips is necessarily talking about the trips that are longer than 5 kilometers. So as our cities and districts are going to grow economically further, it is likely that we will have more share of long distance trips. This will increase and pressurize the need for having provision of motorized transport system. Now, in that case, people will obviously have two options. One is to go for personal motorized transport or go for public transport. Now, public transport obviously has to come from the city authorities. Not only this, we had also tried to model the impact of different development-related parameters on the trip length distribution in the cities. And what we had found is that as the secondary sector contribution, percentage total workers, and the population is likely to increase, we are going to have more and more trips that will be of long distance, right? However, it also says that as the urban density increases, the share of long distance trips decreases. Now, this is very important, where it is also giving us emphasis. It is providing us a broad strategic recommendation where it says that yes, the cities will grow economically and by population. But if we are able to maintain the urban densities, we can avoid the sprawl as far as possible. Then that is where we can avoid and reduce the share of long distance trips that is likely to happen when cluster group 2 cities will move to the cluster group 1 cities, right? So now, in transport sector, we normally talk about the behavior of the people, and that has a major role to play. So we also say that this behavior is determined by the long-term decisions, medium-term decisions, and the short-term decisions, or the changes in the environmental conditions. So the long-term decision, for example, could be where people are choosing their places to work and live. And that has influence on the medium-term decisions, which can include, for example, whether they should go and buy more and more vehicles or whether they should continue to use public transport system. And that in turn influences the daily activity pattern, how people are accessing the different transportation modes and how they are accessing the different opportunities. So we can relate it to the theory of practice, which is basically a routinized type of behavior that is determined by various elements that are interconnected with each other, which can include, for example, the daily activity patterns, how people perceive, what is their knowledge about the environment, what is their knowledge about how the different other systems are functioning in that environment, and what is their knowledge about various aspects and how informed they are. So it basically, this practice, this theory of practice itself represent a kind of a social order. So when I say that, okay, 20 to 30% of the people are dependent on public transport, so that is a kind of a social order, because yeah, maybe not every day me and you are traveling by the same mode of transport, but yes, at regional level or at meso scale, we can still say that there is a behavior that 20 to 30% of the people will be using public transport system, right? And then comes the disruption. Now, disruptions can be classified into various types. One, obviously, is the man-made disruptions, which can include, for example, the policy changes, the infrastructure provision and management related changes, the changes that are continuously happening in terms of the innovation and implementation of new technologies, but also the short-term changes, for example, the strikes or infrastructure closure. Then there are some natural disruptions. For example, all the disastrous events that happen, like earthquakes, tsunami, extreme weather events, for example, floods, droughts. Then there could be the gradual climate change, for example, the gradual change in the temperature or the gradual change in the rainfall conditions. And now what, as a world, we are facing is the pandemic situation, which is also can be identified or classified under that natural disruption. So what happens is that this natural and man-made disruptions can influence the practice, behavior in short term and long term. And all of this two together can influence the sustainable mobility paradigm. Because of this disruption, people will access the opportunities in different way. And therefore, that may be a change in the short term, but can influence the decisions in the long term. So for example, maybe today it is raining heavily and I'm not going to walk or bicycle, but I'll take out my two-wheeler or four-wheeler. But that is a short-term behavior. But in long-term, maybe I might become more and more dependent on the two-wheeler and four-wheeler. Similarly, what we are facing right now, the pandemic situation, where public transport system, for example, is not functioning. I'll elaborate on this further. And non-motorized system, obviously people were very scared in the earlier days. So in short term, people either avoided going out, but eventually they have to come out because they have to access the different opportunities. So in long term, probably it is going to influence whether the people who are not owning the two-wheelers and four-wheelers, will they start owning them, whether be it be a second-hand. So it will overall change the way people access and what are their affordability limits with respect to the transportation system. Not only this, the energy and emission levels are also likely to get impacted. Now, this is just I have taken from the worldometer, and it is talking about, it is up to, recent data till last night, and it is talking about how in India, the daily registered cases with regard to COVID-19 situation are increasing. Although in the past 3 to 4 weeks, we are seeing that there is a somewhat a decline in the number of cases. However, we cannot be very happy about the situation because and we should be still cautious because what we see from other developed countries, there is always a second and the third wave. So this may come back. So we have to be very careful over here. Now, there are 6 key steps that has been clearly identified to prevent the spread of COVID-19. One, obviously, is keep regularly washing your hands, cover your mouth and face whenever you are coughing. Not with the hand, but probably with the hankies and all. And try to stay at home. Don't go out unless it is not necessary. Maintain at least 6 feet distance. Social distancing needs to be practiced. And keeping the surfaces sanitized. Now, all of this poses challenge, specifically when we are going to talk about the aggregate networks, whether it's the paratransit networks or the public transportation system. Because over there, the question related to the sanitization and maintaining the social distancing can be questionable. So just looking in India, how the things have progressed. In March, last week of March, the first phase of lockdown was announced. And here it was when all the services and sectors, all the industries were suspended to function. In the second phase of lockdown, that was when some all of the sectors were still suspended, but some essential sectors were allowed to function within a given time limits. In the third phase of lockdown, the green, red, and orange zones were identified. Normal bus movements were permitted in the green zones, and these were clearly identified as the zones where there were zero reported infections. And however, the bus movement that was allowed was still supposed to run with only 50% of the capacity, sitting capacity. Then thereafter, we started with the unlock phases. So in the first phase of unlock, when we started talking about reopening the shopping malls, religious places, hotels and restaurants, the second phase of more liberty was given in terms of operationalization of public spaces and definition of the containment zones. In the unlock phase 4, that was September, that happened in September, that was where the public transport system, including the metro system, was allowed to operate with the specific guidelines. So now what happened is, although we see that it was only in September where the public transport system started to operate formally. However, because since the time unlock phase 1 was announced and different public spaces were opened up, so this is where I would rather say the search for the need of public transport was there, because people need to travel, and if you have to make all of these places operational, then you will have a workforce that needs to come, and they may be living far off places where they may not even have access to alternate modes of transport, be it cars or two-wheelers. And therefore, they have to be heavily dependent on the public transport system. So, although this unlock phase in unlock phase four, the public transport system was made operational, but the need came when unlock phase 1 was itself announced. So, looking at how globally this current COVID-19 situation has influenced the travel behavior. I have picked up 4 different case studies published in reputed journals. So from Australia, the insight that we get that even after the unlocks have been announced and the normal activities have resumed, But only 50% of the total activity, travel activity, that was catered by the public transport and paratransit system has resumed. So that means there's a 50% decline in the public transport usage from the baseline period, that is a pre-COVID situation. And but however, there has been an increase in the active modes of transport, which includes your bicycles and walking. In Chicago, similarly, there has been a surge in the grocery shopping, online grocery shopping, after the lockdown was announced. And majority of the people perceive high risk when they are traveling in taxis or pool cars or public transport system. So even if it is basically saying that even if the public transport system is made completely operational, people may not be utilizing it because of this risk perception. Then from Netherlands, it has been identified that it's the walk trips that are the least affected. However, the public transport trips are negligible as compared to the pre-COVID situation. And in Canada overall, there had been a reduction in the total number of trips happening by almost 50%. So in totality, what we see is, first of all, the total number of trips have declined. Total number of trips by public transport systems have declined. However, the good news is that the number of bicycle users and the number of pedestrians on road have increased. So this is what I say as the challenge, and this the impact on the non-motorized transport can be seen as the opportunity. So let us try to understand how this situation may replicate to the Indian situation. And what do we see over here is, the distribution of work trips by public transport and paratransit system in the cities of India having more than 5 million population. And what do we see over here? That in Mumbai, around 52% of the total trips are catered by the paratransit and public transport, where rail-based transport serves the majority of the trips. This is followed by Kolkata, then Bangalore and Delhi, where majority of the trips are catered by the bus-based transportation. So we can say that in Ahmedabad, which is the least, almost 18%, and to Mumbai, which is almost 52%, this is the kind of range that we can see over here. And these are the trips that are mostly likely to get impacted because of the COVID situation. Now, we need to relate this data with the trip length distribution, how these trips are distributed, these public transport and paratransit trips are distributed with respect to the distances. So what do we see over here? That majority of the trips that happen by auto rickshaws or taxis, they are up to a maximum of 5 kilometers. And then we see there's a sharp decline. So we can see almost 20% to 50% of the paratransit trips are basically the trips that happen up to 5 kilometers. Similarly, with respect to bus, we see that similar rates are seen over here. 20 to 40% of the total trips that happen by bus are up to a distance of 5 kilometers, right? And then in trains, we see that majority of the trips happen after 5 kilometers. So that means they are longer than 5 kilometers. So now, the problem in today's time is, first of all, even if the public transport system is operating, it is operating only at 50% capacity. Second, people perceive higher risk when they are going to use these aggregated services. And third, we need to be concerned about the operators, from the operators' perspective, and specifically the private sector operators of public transport system, about their financial viability, and such that they can maintain their staff and maintain their fleet. So what are the key challenges for the public transport sector in today's time? How the existing public transport users are likely to be impacted? What will happen to the existing public transport infrastructure that we have built? And how people who are getting impacted are going to access their opportunities? And if there is a change in the behavior, the way they access the opportunities, how is it going to influence their affordabilities? Because are the prices going to change? Are they going to use alternate modes of transport that are going to be more costly and more expensive on their pockets? And overall, because of that change in the behavior, how will it influence the emissions and the energy consumptions? And will these short-term changes, I really hope that COVID situation does not stay beyond 2020 December. So if that really happens and we can still call that as a short-term impact, will it influence the long-term decisions like changing the place of residence or changing the place of work? Also, whether they will change their vehicle ownership patterns, will there be more number of vehicles on road? It is still unknown. So coming back to my previous slide, what are the trips, what kind of public transport trips are under the threat? So minimum 80% of the work trips, like I said, in Ahmedabad are likely to get influenced that happen by public transport and paratransit. And maximum 52% of the work trips that happen in Mumbai are likely to get impacted. Now, if everybody is given an equal choice and if everybody is given a liberty, then they would obviously choose for motorized two-wheeler and cars. Because through various studies, it has been found that these two modes of transport are perceived as the most safe in the pandemic situation. Now, if that happens, so not only the congestion levels will increase, but also it will influence the affordability, safety, energy consumption, and emission levels. And therefore, we need to address this. So, however, the good news is that earlier, which used to be a bad news, that most of the users are the captive users. So most of the users of public transport and non-motorized transport systems are the captive users. That means there is a clear distinction in the way people access the opportunities by income levels. So people who belong to higher income levels, they are the ones that are least dependent on the public transport system. Whereas the people who are more from the lower income groups and who do not own two-wheelers and four-wheelers, they are more dependent on the public transport system or non-motorized transport system. So because of the affordability of the personal motorized transport in India, we can still say that there is a proportion of public transport trips that are likely not to be shifted, right? So therefore, what kind of shifts? If I talk about public transport can go to the motorized two-wheelers, and all of the trips, whether long distance or short distance, all of the trips can go on motorized two-wheelers. However, the kind of people, if I look into the socioeconomic strata, then probably it will be the higher income groups who can afford two-wheelers will shift towards the personal motorized transport. Whereas when we talk about the bicycles or walking, so all the trips that are happening between 2 to 5 kilometers, they can easily move towards bicycles. But most of the users that we can expect will belong to the low income groups. So we can say in general that what are the potential trips, additional trips that can come onto bicycles will be the existing 20 to 40% of the paratransit users that are likely to shift to bicycles. 30 to 50% of the bus users can also shift to the bicycles. And 10 to 15% of the existing train users can also shift to the bicycles in cities. So therefore, we can say that there is, if appropriate design, if appropriate infrastructure is put into place, then we can easily capture this percentage of trips and attract it to more low carbon mode of transport. So from public transport, we can still attract these trips to the non-motorized modes of transport. And what we need to be worried then would be for the remaining set of the public transport trips, because they are long distance trips. So recently some of the news articles that says that cycle sales have doubled, and some papers have also said that there has been a 10 times increase in the bicycle sales. So it is all the good news that people are shifting towards the usage of bicycle, probably because of the closure of public transport system, but also because people are more concerned now about their physical health. Also, various cities have started implementing bicycle infrastructure plans where certain set of corridors are being implemented, are being constructed for bicycle tracks. and which can help the potential bicyclist to move towards bicycles easily. So now the question remains, what will happen to the captive users, the users who cannot move from public transport because they have, first of all, they travel longer, and second, they cannot afford other modes of transport. And then what can be done to capture the potential sustainable transport users, that means the non-motorized transport users. So based on this entire analysis, I've just come up with three broad strategic recommendations. First is, we have to continue with the operation of public transport system, where government authorities need to fund more. They have to provide more subsidies. And not only that, these public transport systems need to be operated with certain set of guidelines. For example, CRI has recently released a guideline for operation of public transport and paratransit system in cities during COVID situation. So major findings from that toolkits are that they should operate at lesser capacity. Alternative seating arrangements should be ensured. Then queuing for boarding and alighting. However, it can result in increasing the boarding and alighting time or the dwelling time. So the care should be taken in that sense also. Sanitation equipment on board need to be provided. And careful sanitation strategies need to be taken care of whenever the person leaves the seat. And a positive news has to be, I'm so sorry, something happened. Yeah. And positivity has to be spread in terms of ensuring the users that they are safe while they are traveling in public transport system, because all the precautions are being taken care of. Then second comes the non-motorized transport infrastructure, which can help in attracting the potential public transport users to non-motorized transport users. So that means even with the lesser capacity of public transport system, we can still serve the needy public. And with regard to non-motorized transport infrastructure, appropriate design and infrastructure has to be provided for safe bicycling and walking. Laws and policies have to be strengthened to prioritize bicyclists on roads so that their safety can be ensured. Because we have varying temperatures and varying weather conditions in India, we have to ensure that street greening activities are taken care of and bicycle tracks are made such that they are mostly shaded in the during the daytime. Not only this, both of these strategies can help us in paving a long way. That is, once we are able to attract the potential users to non-motorized, we can retain them for a longer period of time, even when the COVID situation has gone. However, it would require some urban development and management strategies, which can include provision of conducive environment to encourage non-motorized transport and the services for operationalization of non-motorized transport. Now, this was from the passenger transport side. However, like I had told you, shown you earlier, that from various cities, the examples of increased online shopping are also seen. So we, in last semester at TELI, we just conducted a pilot survey across different sectors. And we identified how this online shopping has changed in different segments. So this is with regard to the FMCG. And as you can see, the number of trips made by the shopkeepers in terms of providing deliveries have increased. So almost 74% of the shopkeepers have said that their home-based deliveries have increased, which has also resulted in increase in the fuel usage from their perspective. Then with regard to the daily basic needs, which includes your vegetables and milk, dairy products, it has been found that there has been an increase again over here in terms of the number of home deliveries made during the COVID situation as compared to the pre-COVID situation. And then we also looked into the apparel industry, and we found that specifically in East Delhi, there people are perceiving that more and more users are perceiving that online shopping is the safest mode for meeting their needs. And also these users have identified that they are using more and more personal motorized transport to be able to access the different services. So three key things that are highlighted from here: that our fuel usage may increase or decrease because we are moving to the online shopping. If appropriate measures are not taken care of, then because of the increased number of trips, it may result in increased road traffic situation and increased risk on roads. And there may also be a shift towards more personal motorized transport. However, since the survey is limited in number, so we are not very still sure with these how it replicates to other areas of Delhi or other parts of the country. But in broader sense, we could identify what were the challenges and what could be the recommendations. So the challenges for home deliveries include, for example, there's increased cost of service, there is lack of appropriate parking spaces, specifically when the home deliveries are to be made. There is unsupportive transport infrastructure for the movement of the people who are delivering the products and services. Also, there is lack of technological know-how amongst the vendors on how to club the orders and how to provide the deliveries in the most efficient way. Amongst customers, there is a perceived lack of trust in terms of the quality, in terms of the quantity, and also in terms of the safety with regard to the COVID situation. And sometimes even after the order is placed, it is found that the stock is not available, which again results in increasing the distrust amongst the customers. So few of the recommendations that we have drafted is that there is a need for low-cost delivery systems, which can be incorporated by clustering the orders and the trips by distance and the weights and the type of products. Shift to cleaner modes of transport like e-two-wheelers can be looked into, so that road-related emissions can be reduced. And as far as possible, incorporation of local vendors for provision of home deliveries should be taken care such that the trip lengths are not increasing, because otherwise we are again coming back to the question of, are we going to increase our emission levels? So if the deliveries, for example, I'm sitting in South Delhi, and if the delivery is to be made for a product from East Delhi, which I could easily get access from South Delhi itself, then it will not make much sense. It will result in increasing the trip lengths, and it will also result in increasing the more usage of transportation system, and therefore more energy consumption and emissions. So we have to see that how do we integrate the local vendors in the home delivery based or online shopping based system. So the three way forward, other than the strategic recommendations, are we need to understand how people are changing their behaviors and how this change is happening with respect to the different incomes, gender and age, and different locations of the cities. Not only this, we before coming up with an appropriate strategy, we also need to understand what are the risks associated if people are going to use the aggregated transportation networks, and how those risks can be abated. Then in last, we have to understand how these vulnerabilities spread across different income groups. Not everybody has equal flexibility to work from home, for example. Not everybody has equal flexibility to go for online shopping. So how do we address those vulnerabilities that arise because of various factors? And how this is resulting in increasing exposure to the coronavirus situation. So with this, I will end my talk over here, and I look forward for the questions from your side. Thank you.
Thank you very much, Dr. Deepthi. It was so enlightening and very, very informative. Thank you very much for your presentation. So you highlighted right in the beginning, and rightly so, the challenges of city growth and how they are connected with natural calamities, and coming spot on to the pandemic. You know, when you talk about increasing the usage of non-motorized transport and also public transport, do you think, you know, in the current urban scenario, In fact, some of it has already been pointed out during your presentation. Whether it is going to be an easy task, or do we really have to work on all fronts, a coordinated approach from the stakeholders, right from the grassroots to the policymakers, is required. You know, because when the place of work is situated at quite a distance from the house, you know, from the homes of the people. For example, you can see in Delhi NCR region, when people live in NCR and they travel to Delhi to work for obvious reasons, lower cost of living, availability of space, etc. So the distance is quite a bit, and the usage of public transport and public transport in the pre-COVID times was quite normal, but during the pandemic, it is quite a challenge. And of course, non-motorized transport looks to be out of an option for long distance travel, especially in metro cities where the weather situations is very, very uncertain. You can see in Hyderabad, it's been raining heavily, floods are there. And in Delhi, very, very hot temperatures, etc. So it's not very feasible for the use of non-motorized transport. And during the COVID times, as you can see, the challenges of sanitized transportation, as you pointed out in your presentation, that remains again a challenge. Plus the punctuality of the public transportation, people wait in queues for hours and hours, and especially now when there is a directive that only 20 people have to be accommodated in buses, for example, or even in auto rickshaws. So that again becomes a challenge. And then the amount of time that is taken, you know, for them to travel, because at one bus stop it is late, and then further it becomes late, and hence it becomes a challenge, and it dissuades people from using these public transports. Vis-a-vis the West, you know, if it is written in the Google Maps that at this point of time, at this time, if the buses are coming, it definitely reaches during that time, at that time. So there's a lot of lag in that. And of course, the weather, the pleasantness of the weather is not very favorable. So what are your views on these couple of points? And closely related to this, I would club one more point, is that, you know, when we are talking about urban creation of compact vertical cities or urban spaces, the mobility needs to suit these urban spaces. But do we, in fact, in all our recommendations and the strategies, we tend to ignore the compact settlements, the slums, the peri-urban areas, so to say, where people live in really congested conditions, and public transports, it is difficult for those transportation to actually reach those areas. And again, people have to either walk or take another form of transportation or their own vehicles. So then mobility becomes restricted. So is the policy paradigm of sustainable mobility in these spaces, in these compact settlements, are these thoughts a myth? And how do we go ahead and resolve these? So in fact, these are a couple of points, initial couple of points. Your views, quick take on this. Thank you.
Thank you, Simi. I think you were, asked the right question. So I would say there are three things that you're highlighting, or you're posing question from the perspective of distances. And if the distances are longer and public transport is not going to be used, then what will happen? And then with regard to the extreme weather conditions and the change in the weather conditions as well, and the current pandemic situation. So there are three broader topics that I have been able to identify. So first of all, we need to understand that the distances in Indian cities are specifically not so long. I mean, I won't say that 100% of the people are traveling short distance, but there is very less share of people who actually travel longer distance. So if you recall my graph around the trip length distribution, even in Delhi, 50% of the people are traveling less than 5 kilometers. So, like I said earlier, that various studies from Indian context only have identified these as the acceptable distances for bicycling. Then comes the long distance trips that goes beyond 5 kilometers. So we can easily say that up to 5 to 10 kilometers are the trips that can easily come onto the bus system. And then anything though that goes beyond 10 kilometers, even that you have seen in different graphs that I had shown you, where you can see that it is beyond 10 kilometers when the usage of rail-based transport system increases, right? So, and that kind of share is very less. So it's only in Delhi where we have 50% of the people who travel longer than 5 kilometers. But in all other cities, especially the tier two cities, we find that up to 70% of the people are traveling shorter distances. So I think that is not much of a worry. Only we need to address right technology. We need to have appropriate infrastructure so that the people who are relying on public transport system for shorter distances, they can think about using, non-motorized transport system. Because eventually, if you look into that time distribution around the space, that does not vary very much in shorter distances between non-motorized transport and public transport. I mean, just imagine that you start your journey from home, you travel at least 500 meters. So let's say you walk for 500 meters to access bus stop, right? And there you wait for 5 minutes. So 10 minutes of, you can say walking and 5 minutes of waiting. Okay, and that means 15 minutes. Then almost you spend 20, 25 minutes depending on the distances you travel. So if you're traveling, let's say 3 or 4 kilometers by bus, so that means around 20, 25 minutes you're going to spend on the bus system in current paradigm. And then again, you get down and then you again travel, let's say 100, 200 meters back to your destination. So in general, it comes down to 20 plus 15. I'm just doing the quick calculation. So around 40, 45 minutes, if you are using bus-based system for 5 kilometers distance. Now, with an average speed of 8 to 10 kilometers per hour on bicycle, you can imagine that you will be saving a lot of time. So it's only about what kind of infrastructure you are providing and whether you are actually making that infrastructure attractive enough and safe enough that people start using it. So like I had also shown you earlier that around easily we can convert even in today's time, 30 to 50% of the population who are using public transport, specifically bus, to our bicycle-based system. So that means we now need to address only the demand of 50%. So with 50% capacity and a little more surge in the public transport infrastructure, we should be able to achieve that target. Now comes the question of weather. This is one of the questions that always comes up, specifically when we start comparing ourselves with the developed countries. But if we carefully look into, then although we have extremes, extreme summers and extreme winters, but our extremes are not as extremes as extreme winters in Europe. I mean, you cannot imagine bicycling over the snow, right? So, but still people do cycle over there. So weather becomes a question. In terms of specifically using bicycling or walking, only if we do not have infrastructure in space. Because then we are trying to find excuse that it's very hot, I'll not use, or it's raining, I'll not use. Even with regard to rains, I've stayed over there in Europe and you will see that it rains almost 90% times of the day. So, and in cold weather too. So that means at least we are not having that kind of situation. So still we can use that even in extremes. Yes, but the kind of changes that we are seeing in these weather extremes, for example, with regard to Delhi, there has been more number of days with severe hot days. Similarly, we have seen examples of high rain intensity in various cities. That is where the concern is, because people are likely to shift out of public transport and non-motorized transport system during those times, during the extreme weather conditions. And that is where my concern also lies, because that is where the first change happens for the short-term duration. So maybe people may avoid traveling, or they may, use, for example, Ola, Uber, taxis to access opportunities. Now, once they are able to see that it's comfortable and it's accessible and it's affordable, maybe that kind of behavior gets start reflecting on the long-term decisions, which means buying vehicles. So yes, during those times, what kind of steps that the government can take? For example, augmenting public transport services. There had been few examples from other cities which talks about door-to-door provision of public transport systems during extreme weather conditions, provision of public transport systems on demand. So basically, you are using your paratransit fleet to do that. So those kind of opportunities can be realized, or those kind of strategies can be realized, so that your shifts that happen for short term from public transport and non-motorized transport to personal motorized vehicles, they do not start reflecting on the long-term decisions. Then pandemic situation, yes, but also there's a decline in the number of trips that are being made. So almost 60 to 70% of the total trips that were happening earlier are happening now. So that means there's lesser demand. And like I said, that there is a potential to shift towards bicycle, so that is also possible. That we, with the reduced capacity of buses and metro systems, we should be able to cater to the demand that is there. Now, if metro system can provide us information on when your metro is going to arrive, I think that is possible in today's time. With regard to buses, and we have examples. I mean, look into Ahmedabad, for example. Even in Delhi, that used to be the case, but now we don't have anymore. So, yes, so BRT system can be identified as one of the best possible solution with regard to buses, where you can ensure on time or punctuality of the buses, or reliability with regard to the time, with regard to the buses. And that can help in attracting again the users back to the public transport systems. I hope I have addressed most of the questions that you have.
Yeah, sure, sure. Thank you so much. Thank you. Actually, when you were talking about, in fact, it is actually very healthy to bicycle or walk to work or move in non-motorized transportation. And we have also seen that there has to be a slight change in perceptions that even a suited booted person is bicycling to work, as against the natural understanding that it is people from the lower middle class or lower classes who cannot afford, you know, they are biking to work. But here I find it very interesting, you know, when we talk about change in perceptions, it can be any professional person who is biking to work, right? So how about the gender question over here? How about women? You know, they and the Indian dressing sense of formal dresses, and most of the women wearing saris or you know, even salwar kameez. So this can come as a challenge when you are using public, when you're using your biking. And plus, I think we need to ensure that everybody knows how to bike, because there are many people who do not know how to ride a bicycle. So yeah, these were my few observations when it comes to, if you have to respond to this.
I would like to take it up. So yes, across literature, it has been identified that socio-cultural conventions of the society, and specifically with regard to dressing, has posed challenges in picking up bicycling by the women. But I mean, talk about the millennium population, you and me. I mean, we have all the opportunities at hand. So I think specifically when we talk about the urban areas, this is no more a challenge, specifically when we are talking about the women who are going to work. And even with salwar kameez, you can easily bicycle. You can see even the old age videos, you know, where people, these actresses are wearing salwar kameez and they're biking. So I think that is not an issue, but yes, it has become more of a blockage from our side. So we need to break that convention, and that convention has come because, like you rightly said, it's the lower, you know, biking is something identified as associated with the lower income. But I think this paradigm is changing, and somewhere thanks to coronavirus, I myself started biking, and now if you go on any roads on Delhi, you will see people wearing fancy bicycles and they are riding. Although as of now, I feel that they are still riding only for health purpose, for example, in the morning or evenings. But with appropriate steps, now the opportunities are already provided. You know, people have owned the bicycle. People have even started showcasing it on various social media platforms. Yeah. So earlier, which the same bicycle which used to be associated with lower income group or the person who does not have access to any other modes of transport, is now becoming a status symbol. So status of health. So I think the opportunity is there now. And like you say, that the rod is hot and hit it right. So okay. It's the government now who needs to intervene and provide policies, provide infrastructure. Some governments have started taking up steps. Some cities have started building up infrastructure, which is also a good news for us. For example, recently within Smart Cities campaign, for the 100 smart cities, a new challenge has been launched, which is about for bicycle infrastructure only. So the city that can come up with the best plan for the bicycle infrastructure and can implement it. So this competition itself amongst the cities and the citizens can help in boosting the image of bicycle. So I think that blockage that we have, whether it's about the socio-cultural convention of the society or the dressing, or whether it's regard to the income groups and the status symbol, this will break soon. It's not a very far from here, but yes, continuous efforts, we are still very naive in this. So continuous efforts and efforts in appropriate directions are required.
Yes, absolutely. Perfect. Thank you, Deepthi, for this. And I would like to add to this point is that, we need to have in this long-term strategy the needs of the differently abled in place, the safety in the public transportation. These need special care, especially in the infrastructure design, as you had pointed out, that we need to have proper cycling zones or cycling specially demarcated for cycling. Especially when we see that there are so many daily incidents of overspeeding accidents, then crossing over to the crossing over of these speeding vehicles to the pedestrian zones, etc. So these need to be put in place. In fact, I believe that, as you said, that it is a blessing in disguise, coronavirus, so the pandemic. So, in fact, it is the right time to correct the shortcomings in urban mobility right now. And in fact, this will herald a new long-term strategy. So, your views on this, Dr. Deepthi?
So, yes, absolutely. Law and enforcement has to go hand in hand with when infrastructure provision is being talked about. Not only with regard to overspeeding, many times infrastructure is built for pedestrians and bicycles, and it is encroached by the local vendors. It is encroached by the two-wheelers movement. It is also encroached by four-wheelers for parking. So, these encroachments, basically, we require regulatory systems, we require laws and policing in an effective way, such that once the infrastructure is built, it is not used for other ancillary services. It is used for the purpose for which it has been designed. Then, with regard to overspeeding, if we have appropriate bicycle tracks, and there are specific guidelines, as per Indian Road Congress Urban Street Guidelines, there is proper provision of on which kind of roads, what kind of infrastructure for bicycling and walking needs to be provided. And on most of the roads where higher speeds are recorded, as per the guidelines, it says that you should have separate cycle track. So it is basically talking about segregating the high-speed vehicles from the slow-moving vehicles. So that can help in ensuring a safer society for bicycles and pedestrians. But yes, enforcement also has to go along with the engineering.
Yes, absolutely. Yeah. Especially when we have the new Motor Vehicles Act in place with enormous amounts of challans and fines. Okay. I think at least this is being taken care of, especially when your fines are reaching to your mobile phone within a minute and reaching your homes in your address. So definitely. But more than fear of the law, of breaking the law, I think there has to be a wider sensitization campaign that following the rules is actually the pathway for everybody to coexist in a peaceful manner. Mm-hmm. So thank you very much for your comments and responding to my queries so wonderfully. I would now invite Dr. Arjun Kumar to make his brief comments and perhaps ask a few questions before we sign off. Thank you. Dr. Arjun Kumar, over to you.
Thank you. Thank you, Dr. Simi Mehta. I would really like to congratulate Dr. Dipti Jain for putting across such a wonderful presentation, having so many of things to talk about. Mobility, and especially sustainable mobility, such a vast topic, metro, bicycle, so many things. We have tried to develop many things. Terry is also now our partner at hashtag Planet Talks. Perhaps we'll look into more the nuances of this from more data, statistics, and also theory approaches going ahead. I really wanted to talk upon some of the points, especially which is arising. As we know from Census 2011, that we are a bicycle nation, of course. You know, 50% of the household who have any mode of transport, the rest 50 do not have. Out of that 50, the 90% have bicycles. Rest, the 10% or the 5% of the household have any motorized transport. So yes, we are a bicycle nation. And as in New Delhi, we are witnessing and everywhere that new cycles, you know, cycles are pumped up, rightly so, environment consciousness, health consciousness. A new push has been also given, also thanks to the social media. Regarding this, I really wanted to touch upon the bicycle infrastructure. Really, in the last 5 years or so, the experiences of Indian cities, let us forget the rural areas, has not been, I would say, friendly. The PPP, not even PPP, when the government or even the Jawaharlal Nehru University have that cycle push app and other things. In my locality in Saket, there is this electrical cycle which you can, from the app, you can have that. That is really very, I would say, convenient and it's helpful. But why is it not working? Ma'am also mentioned BRT. BRT has few success, but in Delhi, we have just, you know, that project is vanished, and in fact we are celebrating the success. So what is going wrong in terms of public infrastructure pertaining to this bicycle promotion? Next, I would really ask that associated with bicycle is also the pedestrian infrastructure. None of our cities have any that sort of pedestrian thing that you can walk for like 5 kilometers without having something coming up or not. So what will be the push? Simi also asked the new Motor Vehicles Act. I really wanted to add upon the electric vehicle policy. There has been a lot of resistance from the private sector that how will it be done. The government is trying to push Niti Aayog. Now, what is your view regarding that? And also, what are we doing with our diesel vehicles? In most of, like in Delhi, we are banning it, you know. But in hills and other areas, diesel vehicles are really leading to a lot of pollution. So what is your view regarding the same? Another thing which I really wanted to ask, perhaps the time is right now, that despite having this COVID lockdown and so many of restriction, the pollution and the air quality, really, there are other exogenous factors, of course, for the deterioration of air quality in our cities. But how the sustainable mobility, especially after this pandemic, what push can the transport sector or the mobility sector? We also have the National Urban Transport Policy of 2006. Do we need to revisit it? What are the new changes which can be done? And really, what all should be the push from the infrastructure point of view? Because we have, I would say, so many of investment, national infrastructure pipeline that also have significant amount of transport related projects, highways and so many things. So how that should be integrated with affordable and also clean, which is also good for environment, or let us say pedestrian and bicycle, to integrate into that. Give that thought to the policy makers and let that things to be happen with the joint collaboration of the citizens. Another thing which I really wanted to ask, that ma'am has really highlighted things about density in urban and rural areas. In terms of water supply or any other infra push, we see that the urban areas and rural, so many difficulties, because in rural remote areas, if you have to give water supply, that's, you know, a different, entirely different ball game for that infrastructure cost and finances, other things. Now there is also revenue foregone from metro, buses, many things. What implication will it have to the mobility sector or transport sector, and how we can take this as an opportunity to change things towards more green push? So what should be done in small towns? What should be done in big cities? What should be done in peri-urban areas or rural areas? Are there anything A, B, C you want to advise for this? And really, my last thing to add, ma'am, you are also doing surveys on the new online delivery and other things. How can we integrate real-time data to have evidence-based policy, especially for sustainable mobility, so be it bicycle or be it other things, you're measuring all the trip and other things. How can revenue and affordability can also be integrated so that it makes more sense to, I would say, each of the service user or beneficiary of all this public transport or even private transport, having environment in the mind. Thank you once again, Dr. Dipti Jain, and over to you.
Thank you, Dr. Arjun, for exciting questions. And obviously, they're spreading across various dimensions. So yes, why bicycle? Why being a bicycle nation? It has always been a question. We have, in fact, declined in terms of the usage of bicycles over a period of time. Specifically, if you start looking into the data from last 2 to 3 decades, you'll see that there is a sharp decline in terms of the bicycle usage in the cities. And more specifically, it has to do with increasing income levels and people having an aspiration to buy and own vehicles. So I think that is the push factor from, or rather, I would say it is a pull factor from the people's perspective, because they want to own and more vehicles, because we had not been a vehicle dependent society. Now, when it comes that, okay, we already have a bicycle master plan, for example, in Delhi was approved in 2008. And we have, like I said earlier, that in IRC, Indian Road Congress guidelines for urban streets, it also defines what kind of bicycle infrastructure is required. But what happened when it goes to the implementation stage? Now, I would say that many times when it goes into the implementation, first of all, we need to understand that it is recently only, because of health concerns, environmental concerns, that we people or higher middle income group and higher income groups are thinking about bicycles. Earlier, it used to be a mode which was meant for the low income groups of society. Now, low income groups of society, they have various other challenges to deal with, which are more crucial for them rather than talking about transport safety. So they will raise their voice, for example, for food, shelter, jobs, education, but not transport. So that pull factor that was required from the people's perspective is, we can say, that was non-existent. Now, even after the guidelines were issued, still we see that there are fewer cities that actually implement them. Now, one of the reasons is that there is a myth around developing bicycle infrastructure, which revolves around space and money. So and this is also one of the reasons why BRT was not successfully further taken up in Delhi. One of the reasons is that whenever you allocate a space on road, for alternative modes of transport. So whether it's bicycle or it's bus. So there is a strong voice that is raised from the people who are owning and using the cars, saying that this space could have been utilized for cars and therefore minimize congestion and increase speeds on the roads. So that that myth itself result, although the average speeds, for example, may remain same, but it's a myth. People consider that if I would have one more lane, then probably I could have traveled faster. So that had resulted in somewhere not successful implementation of whether it's BRT or bicycle tracks or bicycle related infrastructure in the cities. So that is space, and then second comes around the money. So people think that it costs a lot, but both pedestrian and bicycle infrastructure really does not cost much. So that myth needs to be broken up. And if the middle income group and higher income group start moving towards the usage of bicycles and they start raising their voice, I believe that in coming years, it will be heard and the things will be implemented in positive direction. Now, second comes with regard to the electric vehicles, that electric vehicles is being pushed up as a policy. And but there is a lot of resistance, and again over here there are both potentials and challenges. My own perception with regard to electric mobility is that when we are talking about electric mobility for passenger vehicles, that means the personal motorized transport, I have my reservations. I hold my reservations over there, because first of all we need to understand that the total percentage share of people using cars is very less in India. Delhi being the having the highest per capita income amongst all the cities in India, still only 10% of the people in Delhi are using cars. So you can imagine, even if I take up a model of Norway and happen to implement 30%, have a penetration or market share of 30% or 12%, then still only a very few percentage of few number of cars are going to get converted into electric vehicles. Then second, who is owning the cars? Cars are still owned by the higher income groups, but still majority of the segment or majority of the people who own the cars are the single car owners. So it's not going to happen that if I have to travel long distance, then I'll maintain a second car or IC vehicle, and for shorter distances or daily based travel, I'm going to maintain a second vehicle. So the efficiency of the electric cars is itself a question as of now. Then third comes around the battery wastage that is going to be generated. So I think these all three aspects, along with what will happen to the grid, what kind of grid will be required, what will happen to the electricity supply. As such itself, right now we are almost 6% deficit in terms of energy supply. And not only that, globally we consume only 1/3 electricity per capita. So that means our electricity demand per capita is going to increase as people are going to increase by income, and economic status is going to increase. So people are going to rely more on the appliances and more on the services that are supported by electricity. So given all of this, the impact of electric vehicles that will pose an additional burden to the electricity demand. So there are different those challenges which relate to the waste management, which relates to the electricity supply, the clean grid. All of this pose challenges towards converting IC vehicles to the electric vehicles. But yes, when it comes down to, for example, electric vehicles for aggregated networks, then there I still see that there is good potential over there. Because specifically for the intra-city movements, because the kind of trips that are catered over there, and with regard to batteries and charging and everything, those kind of infrastructure and provisions can be made. For example, battery swapping and all. So we have to be very careful when we are, looking into this electric vehicles, for which segment we should push and which segment we should not push too much. COVID and its impact on pollution and air quality. Yes, initially we had seen during lockdown, because all the activities, including industries all across India and globe, shut down, and it has had a positive impact on air quality levels. But however, like I had mentioned earlier, that public transport usage is going to reduce. And if that shift happens towards motorized two-wheelers and cars, then we can see this as a big challenge in terms of increasing emission levels and degrading air quality levels. So yes, supportive infrastructure, like I said, I had mentioned earlier as well, that if we have appropriate infrastructure so that we can attract at least the potential bicycle users to bicycles from public transport, then we can still see that the impact of COVID on travel behavior and therefore its impact on air quality will not be much negative. So then last question, I would say that most of our city planning is governed by the master planning approach, and which is statutory in nature. That means it has to be followed. However, we have a provision of mobility and transportation plans, and the team that I was part of earlier, which was around comprehensive mobility planning toolkit, it specifies integration of this land use plan with the transportation plan. So that means here we are talking about densities, here we are talking about the compact cities, and how can we design them, and how we can incorporate that within the transportation infrastructure design. However, the worry is that mobility plan, first of all, is not the prerequisite for planning and implementation of any transportation infrastructure. Second, mobility plan is neither a part of the master plan nor independently it is a statutory document. So that means even if a city is developing a mobility plan with an aim to reduce carbon emissions, it is not necessary that in coming years the city will implement it, because it lacks that statutory status, nor it is integrated with the master plan. So that means whatever outputs that you get from the mobility plans in terms of what kind of city should be, what kind of design should be, what kind of transportation infrastructure should be, is not necessarily going to contribute back towards the development of the master plan. So that lack of that integration is also posing challenge in terms of implementation of sustainable mobility in cities. So from regulatory frameworks or institutional frameworks, I think mobility plans first needs to be institutionalized. Although quite efforts have been made where, for example, if under various schemes, it has been found that if the cities need to avail funding from the central government, then they need to prepare this mobility plan, and that project should be part of the mobility plan. But however, city can take an independent approach as well. City and states can take an independent approach. And in any case, the city transport does not come under the rules of the central, the federal government. So there is a clear distinction over there. So therefore, making that mobility plan as a statutory document or integrating it with the master plan is identified as one of the potential areas where we can intervene. I hope I have answered most of the questions.
Sure. Thank you. Thank you, Dr. Deepthi. And in fact, Professor Jodrez has mentioned that if we look from the satellite, we see that Delhi cars have encroached almost all of the public spaces, and there is no place to walk. So definitely there is a huge space for reform. And I know we have moved beyond time, but there are just two quick questions. Yes. As to do you think this has come up on the from the audience, that do you think that the long term benefit of owning private vehicle is greater than choosing public transport, especially when we talk of India? And if this is so, how to go about persuading the people the long term usage of public transportation? And another thing is, as you draw towards the conclusion of the talk today, what are the opportunities that COVID-19 outbreak has offered, or does it offer, for sustainability transitions in research, design, legislation, and implementation on mobility? So over to you.
With regard to the first question, what is about the long-term benefits of owning private vehicle versus choosing a public transport system? Again, coming back, a very few percentage of people, like even Dr. Arjun has had mentioned earlier, very few percentage of households in India own vehicles. So, it is still a status symbol. and how do we break that? So first of all, we need to understand that already public transport usage in Indian cities is very high. I mean, you see all of the existing public transport system is highly congested. It's highly crowded, right? So now I would rather say maybe don't attract the new users, but at least do something such that the existing users are retained. And that can happen only if you make the public transport competitive enough with the private transport. Now, over here, one important aspect that needs to be highlighted is normally people compare the travel times. If I'm going to use a public transport, how much travel time I'm going to take? If I'm going to use a private transport, how much travel time I'm going to take? Other than that, private transport offers other benefits. For example, again, door-to-door service, door-to-door connectivity, more reliability, you have your own personal space and etc. But public transport, if appropriate infrastructure is put into place, not only the travel time can become competitive to the private transport, but also it can be attractive. For example, there were some videos about using buses. So if you're driving a car, for example, that some glimpse from that video, if you're driving a car, then you can obviously not use your phones, so you cannot read, but if you're using a bus, then you can do both. So that means public transport also offers you a certain set of opportunities. It is also a place where people meet, and you know. So I think the first target for us, and that I had mentioned earlier also, to retain. Shift is the second step. How do we retain the existing users, which are already high in numbers? And that is where the intervention is required. That means make the public transport competitive to the private transport, whether it's in terms of travel time, reliability, or connectivity, integration of the multiple transportation systems. And that can pave a long way towards also pursuing the existing private transport users towards public transport. Now, with regard to opportunities, I think over here I will be repeating myself that first of all, this has given, coronavirus situation has given a lot of flexibility of working from home for majority of the sectors, specifically in urban India. And even the companies and organizations have started realizing it. So even after the coronavirus is not there and we are living in that normal world, not the new normal world, but the normal world, then probably this opportunity can be realized where not every day you are traveling for work. You still participate in the work. You still give your full towards the working, but not every day you are traveling. Then staggering the timings of work hours, office hours can also be seen as one of the opportunity in this case. That is one. Second, because the public transport is not available, people are becoming more and more health conscious. Physical health is identified as one of the parameters that can help in abating the risk of coronavirus. And that is where people have started walking and bicycling and jogging. And you'll see a lot of, for example, in Delhi, you'll see a lot of people on roads now. So that is also one of the opportunities that can be easily realized. So because already the people have now owned the bicycles or now they are biking and they don't find it more unsafe maybe. So it's now easier for government to intervene and implement the infrastructure. And there'll be lesser resistance also. I think people will be in fact supportive of the new infrastructure. So, in short, these are the few opportunities that can be easily realized in the current situation.
Yes, certainly. And as you had mentioned about advertisements, which are very, very important, I think because advertisements build perceptions and then, of course, responses, it is very essential that the public transport as a brand be promoted instead of so as to discourage people from buying a number of vehicles during weddings or as gifts or during, Diwali offer and all those things, instead of just simply moving towards that direction, that would only increase the number of vehicles on the road. So definitely, thank you very much for your wonderful discussion and for taking up questions so generously. And with this, we come to the end of the program. I thank you all, audience on Zoom and also on Facebook Live. The State of the Environment, hashtag Planet Talks with me, Simi Mehta. And I also would like to extend my warm greetings and thanks to India Water Portal, our media partner, and Terry School of Advanced Studies for being our organizing partner. Thank you very much, Dr. Deepthi, for joining us and for your engaging conversation. Thank you very much. Have
Thank
a very
you,
good day.
Thank you, Dr. Simi, for moderating the session.
Thank you. Thank you all. Have a very good day.
Be safe.
You too. Bye-bye.